Number three, Father, we thank you this morning for your word and the time we can spend in it together. We just pray we might be edified and encouraged by these things. And we thank you in Christ's name. Amen. By the way, the other thing I was going to say, tonight at 6 o'clock, we will have Bible study. And I had planned to answer, I've been answering questions on Sunday night. And I have a question that came a couple of weeks ago about why do you, it came off the radio, why do you always close the radio program by saying Maranatha? If you don't know what the word Maranatha means, it's in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, and it's a word that Christians have used for since the first century. I'm going to answer that question tonight. The word itself means the Lord's coming. Today I get here, and I get some information from some people. Somebody is teaching that the rapture is going to take place on the 25th of September. So I'm gonna explain to you tonight why that's not going to happen. If I was the Lord, I'm not, but if I was, and somebody figured out the date that I'd planned for the rapture, I would change it just to screw them up. So that's the reason it's not going to happen that way. But we'll talk about that tonight just so that you know what we're going to do. All right, 1 Timothy chapter 3. Today is Labor Day. It's Labor Day weekend. Tomorrow's Labor Day. Labor Day is the first Monday in September, and now it's a three-day weekend. It originated with the purpose of commemorating labor, honoring laborers, workers. It goes back into the late 1800s, actually, the 1880s, when the trade unions, the labor movements, groups were seeking some recognition and some political standing. In 1887, the state of Oregon passed the very first official Labor Day, and it was in 1894 that the federal government finally came along and established the first Monday in September as an official holiday. 30 states had already by then been made it a holiday. So Labor Day has been a federal holiday for over 100 years. And that first Monday in September, and it's dedicated to, you know, to honoring labor and that kind of stuff. Now it's really just the unofficial end of summer, and it's the weekend. You get your last vacation, your last time away. Like I said, Alex said, there's a lot of our folks are gone today off for that last camping trip. By the way, next weekend we'll be down in Ridge Farm for the Bible conference down there. It's always the weekend after Labor Day. And for those of you that camp, they do have facilities there on Brother Chestnut's farm where you can put your campers. They don't have bathroom facilities. You'd have to have a self-contained camper. But if you have that, they have facilities there, a place there where you can camp. There are campgrounds and so forth. So people ask me about that. So if you want to do that, that's really a good time to have the last vacation. It's also the weekend when sports begin. It's also the weekend when school begins. So Labor Day marks, by the way, thank God college football has started again. My dear wife has been waiting. You know, July is the last month of the year that has no college football. August, you get the preliminaries, and this weekend it starts again. And so you know where my wife is on Saturday evening. She's watching Alabama play ball. We're walking out of the parking lot up there at the fair, and a guy asks her, because she's got, you know, the sign on the back of the car. He says, "You're for Alabama, right?" He said, "Yeah, isn't everybody?" And he says, "Well, he was too." So now my wife and some strangers down the parking lot talking football. And I'm thinking, well, you know, okay, I'll stand here and listen. My wife has two teams that are her favorite team. One is Alabama, and the other is whoever's playing Notre Dame. So I hope both of them won yesterday. I'm not sure. Did they? Okay. Good. I'm happy about that for her. But anyway, Labor Day it has a lot of different things today. It isn't so much about labor as it is about unofficial end of your vacation time, get that last little hurrah. And school's going to start. Now school starts earlier and so forth, but it's still around this time of the year. But laboring is an important thing in the Scripture. Last week I talked to you about the importance of a local church and why we have a local church. The local church is a vehicle for God's work. It's a vehicle for labor. And what actually is the local church supposed to do? If it's this important, a local church is not a part of the vain religious system. You have to understand that. And a lot of folks don't understand that. Most of what you see in Christendom, that's sort of like Florida kind of thing. Most of what you see in Christendom is just a plagiarized form of Judaism, where they've taken the religion of Judaism. God only gave one religion. He gave it to the nation Israel. And then they changed it from the pure religion that God gave them into the Jews' religion. They took the things God gave them and plagiarized them. And most of what Christendom is, with its altars and its sacrifice and its priests and its robes and its design and all the paraphernalia and all the high days and the feast days, all of that is just Judaism brought over and plagiarized into a form of Christendom. That's not what the church is. We're not patterned after the church fathers, after church history, after church tradition. And I don't care who they are. You can go back to the Waldensians and the Lollards and the Anabaptists and the Lutherans and the Anglicans and the Reformed Presbyterians and the Geneva Calvinists and the Brethren movements and the Evangelicals and the New Reform. You take any of them that you want to take. And all the denominational Baptists and fundamentalists and congregate, all of, that's not what the church, the body of Christ, is, and it's not what we do. The church is not a religious building. It is a building. I'll show you that in a minute, but it's not a religious building. It's not a shrine. It's not a temple. Joe and Barbara up in Door County, and they sent a picture of, I don't know what that church was, but it was a Norwegian church. Since I don't speak Norwegian, I can't tell you what it is. But it looked like a Buddhist temple. And they took all these different things and put together and inside. And it's a beautiful thing. If you go in some of these cathedrals, they are beautiful. They are awe-inspiring places. Just like you can go stand on a mountain vista and be inspired. And that's the design. It's designed for your eyes and your senses. That's not what the church is. That's a religious building. It's a shrine. It's a temple. The church is not an organization. The church is the body of Christ. Look at 1 Timothy 3, verse 15. Here's, if you want to know what a local church is, 1 Timothy 3:15. But if I tarry long, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth. Almost every time I read that verse, I try to say to you, the church of the living God at Ephesus, where Timothy is here, there is a church of a dead God. Diana, great is Diana of Ephesus, the great temple of Diana, a beautiful shrine, a beautiful monument. It was one of the seven wonders of the ancient world at Ephesus, and yet it was full of death, spiritual death and alienation and blindness and darkness. The silversmith, the shrine makers, the image makers for aids to worship and so forth, all that religious system that then gets pulled over from that into Christendom, and we think that was the church of the dead God. Diana was called the Queen of Heaven. Listen, the Queen of Heaven's got churches in Chicago, got some out here where we used to meet on Neva in Chicago. Right down the street from us was the church called the Queen of Heaven. Listen, Israel in Jeremiah 44, 700 years before the time of Christ, is chastised by Jeremiah for worshiping the Queen of Heaven. That's not something new. That's a pagan religion from ancient time. And they were worshiping the Queen of Heaven by making little cakes and drink offerings and burning incense, praying to her. Now, if you know anything about what Christendom has been plagiarized into, you know what I just described. And all of that is part of paganism that gets brought up. That's not what Paul's talking about. He said, you're the church of the living God, the true and living God. Hold your hand there, look back at 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. Verse number 9. For they themselves show unto us what manner of entering in we had unto you, and how you turn to God from idols. To do what? To serve the living and true God. We're the church of the living and true God. The pillar, and it's the house of God. A house is a place where God lives. Hold your hand here and come to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Just so you understand this thing about a building. This building is just a building. But this building contains a building. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse number 9. For we, talking about the body of Christ, are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry, His garden. Ye are God's building. So the church is God's, it's the dwelling place where God lives. So we are a building. But it's not this physical building. The body of Christ, one of our markers, one of our identifying markers, is we're a garden. We bear fruit. But we are also the dwelling place of the true and living God. He has a place where He lives on this planet, and it's in us. So we're the place where God lives. Now, you know what a house is, a building is, when you're the house of God, where He lives. But a house describes a family dwelling. It's where a family dwells. It's where God's people live together. So the church is a dwelling of God's people, where people are loved and protected and nurtured and educated and developed and learn their Father's will. They learn how to work together, operate on the values of the family. And that's what a local church is designed to be. It's not a shrine for religious activity. It's a place where life is to be lived together in the family. And you notice the description he uses in verse 15, 1 Timothy 3:15. The church of the living God, where life is, the pillar and ground of the truth. Now that's the function. That's the basic issue of what's going on in the house. The pillar and ground of the truth. The main issue for the church is the truth. The main issue for us is Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He said, when he prayed in John 17 to the Father, he said, Thy word is truth. The word of God is the truth of God. Just like Jesus Christ, the Son of God, is the truth of God. He's truth with a big T. The word's truth with a little T. He's the person. It's the means whereby you know the person. And for us, the issue is the truth of God. It's not the politics of the world. Can I tell you that the politics of the world, at the fair up there, one aisle was the GOP. Another aisle was the Democrats. And all the other aisles were just the world. All of it's the world. You can take all... Listen, in your Bible, democracy, representative democracy, a republic, none of those forms of government are the form of government God's going to establish in this planet. Now, they're about the best man can do, some of it is, and a representative democracy is certainly a representative of Bible truth, but when God sets up a government, you know what it's going to be? It's going to be a monarchy. He's going to be a king in a kingdom, and he's going to be... Look with me at Isaiah chapter 33. Just this isn't in my notes, so I'm ad-libbing now. I've never paid much attention to notes anyway, so... I give Rachel an outline when she's here, that I, you know, and she doesn't use it much because she found out pretty soon, I don't use it much. Isaiah 33, look at verse number 22. Talking about him, Christ setting up his kingdom. For the Lord is our judge. The Lord is our lawgiver. The Lord is our king. He will save us. The judicial system, the legislative system, and the executive branch, the king, the lawgiver, and the judge. Who is it? The Lord Jesus Christ. You're not going to elect him. He's going to appoint himself. He's going to rule with truth. Now, until he comes and does that, you and I have the responsibility to take that truth and apply it the best we can in the circumstances we live in and are able to live in. So that's a wonderful thing. We've had a country where it's been available to us to do as no other place in history in the last 2,000 years, so you can be grateful for that. But my point is, the issue for us is the truth. The issue is not all the political stuff out there in the world, the economic stuff in the world. That doesn't mean you don't get out there. You take truth and apply it to that. Your job out there in that is to take the truth of God and apply it. Because the issue here is God's truth. We're the pillar and the ground of the truth. The reason for the local church and a community is so that the truth of God's word can be available in the community. Otherwise, it won't be there. Now, you're the pillar and the ground. A pillar, that's listed. A pillar is you hold stuff up high where people can see it. The first issue for the local church is to hold the truth up and say, hey, the truth is available. Make it known. Proclaim it. Then we're the ground. The ground is the foundation on which the pillar stands. Without a firm foundation, the pillar will fall over. You can't get the pillar up until you have the foundation secure. Now, the pillar is the first. Listen, the will of God, 1 Timothy 2, verse 4. When I learned years ago that it was this simple, I was so happy. When I was in college, I've told you this before, I went to a liberal arts college in Mobile, Alabama. It's called Mobile College. It's owned by the Southern Baptist Convention. And because it was owned by the Baptist, twice a week they had chapel. And you were required to go. And every semester they have some special speaker come in to challenge everybody. And I was a young guy, and I wanted to preach, and I wanted to serve the Lord. So I'm listening, and they had this evangelist came in, a very famous guy at the time. And he said, you need to do the will of God in your life. And he said, how do you find God's will? And he said, I'm like 27 steps to being in the center of God's will. And you know how they used to do, how they draw a circle on the board and say, the bulls are right in the middle. You want to be right in the center of God's will. Don't be off at 3 o'clock. Don't be off at 9 o'clock. Be right in the center of the God's will. Here, 27 steps. I got my notebook out. Started writing them down. Two buddies with me. We're writing them down. I got 18 of them. We went back to the cafe, started talking among ourselves, and what are we going to do? If there's 27 steps and I only got 18 of them, I'm 9 short. Came to pass. They got theirs out. I think we came up with 21. And we were distraught. We'll never know how to be in the center of God's will. We're always going to be off because we didn't get all of them. And here's this, he knows how to do it because he's been walking. So I wrote him a letter and asked him. We didn't get all. Could you send them to him? He never answered. And we met together, we prayed together, we were interested in doing, serving the Lord. And what are we going to do? And I just kept reading my Bible. And finally, 1 Timothy 2, verse 4 struck me. We're in 1 Timothy, look back at chapter 2. First Timothy 2, verse 3. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, here's God's will, who will have all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. So the first thing I learned from that is God's will is that all men be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. What's God's will? Everything God's doing in the dispensation of grace, and I learned that's where I find God's will for today, Isn't Paul's epistles the discipline? He's not doing Israel's program. He's not doing time past. He's not doing the future. This is what he's doing today. Where do you find God's will? It's in his word. You don't find it in the circumstances of your life. You don't find it in following 27 steps to lead you through all these things and to discern this happens. So that means God wants you to do that. Charles Stanley on the TV, he has the signpost to being in the center of God's will. So that's baloney. That's a guy who didn't know what the will of God is to start with, much less how to tell you to get there. Because he's got this big circle, and he wants you to be right in the center of it. Once you find out, there ain't no circle, and there's no bullseye in the center anyway. The will of God is not something, it's not, you don't find God's will by looking at the circumstances of your life. That's where you go do the will of God. You understand the difference? You don't discover God's will in the circumstances of your life. You discover God's will in his word, and then you take his word and go do it in the circumstances of your life. And he gives you a renewed mind with the capacity for you to look at the circumstances of your life. Say, here's what God's word says needs to happen. God would have all men to be saved, come to the knowledge of the truth. In my life, how do I apply that? And you have a responsibility to grow in grace and knowledge and so forth, to learn how to apply the will of God in your life. So the circumstances of your life is the stage upon which you go do the will of God. You find his will in his word. And his will is first, all men be saved. So when you live your life, everybody you live with, God's will for you there is that those people get saved. So you need to live your life in a way that would be conducive to their getting saved. And once they get saved, God's will is that they then would grow and come to a knowledge of who they are in Christ and how that's operating. So the first issue, hold up the truth. The second issue is for the church to be the ground that makes that truth palatable, truthful, or available, and shining. Look at Philippians chapter 2. I'm trying not to spin my wheels here, but 1 Timothy, Philippians chapter 2, verse 15 and 16. You become the ground of the truth because you possess the truth. Do you understand what a precious thing it is for you and me? We possess the truth of Almighty God. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Do you know how understanding that can change everything in life? Not understanding it sends you into a dither and tailspin where no matter what else you do, you never have any grounding, any stability. Just that. Five words. In the beginning, God created. Paul said, I'd rather speak five words with clarity to them 10,000 in an unknown tongue. Christ died for my sin, for your sins. Little words like that, truth from God's word, give stability that you can't have any other way. Philippians 2, verse 15, verse 14. Do all things without murmuring and disputing, that you may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God without rebuke, in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation, among whom you shine as lights in the world, holding forth the word of life, that I may rejoice. Shining as lights in the world, that you may holding forth the word of life. There's the pillar. I got it up. It's shining. But you see what he says before that? That you be blameless and harmless, the sons of God without rebuke, in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation. There's the ground. There's the stability. There's the foundation. You possess the truth, and then you're going to preserve the truth. You're going to pass on the truth. You're going to understand the truth. You're going to defend the truth, and you're going to see that truth living in you. You're going to provide a foundation that says this truth looks like this, gives this stability. And as you hold it up, that attracts, makes it living. What constitutes a church, a local church? And by the way, look, you're in Philippians. hang on to Philippians and come over to Galatians chapter 1. There is the church, the body of Christ. That's all believers everywhere. But then that's the church. But Galatians chapter 1 verse 2, and all the brethren which are with me unto the churches of Galatia. That's not a bunch of body of Christ. That's a bunch of local churches. So the one body of Christ manifests itself in localities, local geographic areas, in local churches. So a local church, first of all, is a group of believers. It's the body of Christ in a location. They meet regularly in one geographic location. They're churches in Galatia. If you go back to 1 Corinthians chapter number 1. 1 Corinthians 1. Verse 2. Unto the church of God which is at Corinth. Now that's the church, the whole body of Christ is not at Corinth. That's the believers that are at Corinth. Look at chapter number 11. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Verse 17. Now in this that I declare unto you, I praise you not, that you come together, not for the better, but for the worse. So here the saints have come together. Verse 18, for first of all, when you come together in the church, I hear that there be division among you, and I partly believe it. In other words, the saints come together, verse 20, when you come together in one place. So the gathering of the saints together, like we are this morning, you come together in the church. They're not just talking about the building, they're talking about the gathering of the saints together. A local church is a local gathering together of believers in a geographic location. If you go back to Philippians chapter 1, just for a second, that group, Philippians 1 and 1 Thessalonians 5, that local group of believers that gather together, they're not just gathering together for a fellowship meeting. They're not just gathering together for potluck. They're not just gathering together for a study group or for a prayer meeting or for some fellowship group. They're gathering together for a specific purpose. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 12. We beseech you, brethren, to know them which labor among you and are over you in the Lord, and admonish you, and esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake, and be at peace among yourselves. Notice, these saints have gathered together to do a work of the ministry. And they have an organization. They're all there, but some of those that labor among them, they're laboring, they're working in the work. You labor in work. And that local church is a group of believers gathered together in a geographic location for the purpose of doing the work of the ministry. You remember Ephesians 4, Paul says that the apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, and so forth were given for the perfecting of the saints, edifying the saints, for the work of the ministry. Perfected, edified, mature saints do the work of the ministry for the edifying of the body of Christ. So that work of ministry, that's not just a good time. That's not just a fellowship. Listen, you come here, and you come here to learn, you come here to fellowship with one another, but it's not all about you coming here to get stuff. It's you come here to minister to others also. It's a participation thing. Philippians 1, verse 1, Paul and Timotheus, the servants of Jesus Christ, to all the saints in Christ Jesus. So we're all saints. That's why that verse says they labor among you. They're one of you. Which are at Philippi. There's the location. With the bishops and deacons. Now that's 1 Timothy chapter 3, Titus chapter 1. That is, the saints work together and they're led by these elders, the doctrinally and personally sound elders that are assisted by deacons. Their leadership. And what that results in is the maturity of the whole group into the image and likeness, the life of Jesus Christ. So what a local, and I'm saying this so you understand, a local church is not simply just a bunch of guys getting together, a bunch of gals getting together, having a fellowship time. That's wonderful. But a local church is designed, is a group of people gathered together for the specific purpose of doing the work of the ministry. And you've got people gathered together and edified with the ministry trusted to them, where they have leaders, bishops and deacons, the bishops leading and the deacons helping, you know, assisting in it to accomplish the labor, the work, the labor in word and doctrine. And what that results in is the maturity of the body of Christ and the ability to hold up the truth. And it becomes a witness. And what the local church is designed to be is an attractive witness to Christ in a local community that forms the basis for penetrating the community, the culture, the region where they are, with the gospel. So it's not just a fun house, not just a club meeting, and it's not something just to perpetuate an organization, a denomination, or a system. Look with me at Acts chapter 14. In order to know what something is, you have to know when the work's done and when it's finished. The Apostle Paul, through his ministry, has a model of the way the ministry is to be done. If you get Acts 14 to one hand and Romans chapter 15. Romans 15. Paul knew when the job was done. He knew what the job was because he knew when it was finished. If you don't know when it's finished, then you never get finished because you don't know what you're trying to accomplish. I'll give you I'm going to just use one illustration. There are many in Paul's epistles, but this passage, the thing in Thessalonians, 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, to me, this is such a model. Romans chapter 15, if you start in verse 16, start in verse 8. I'm sorry, it's just hard for me to pick up a verse, you know, in the middle of stuff. In verse 8, he says, Now I say that Jesus Christ was a minister of the circumcision, for the truth of God to confirm the promises unto the fathers. In time past, Jesus Christ was the minister. He was the spokesman of God for the truth of God to confirm the promises made to the fathers. But then he changed the program. And the program changes from that which is spoken by the mouth of all the holy prophets since the world began. Alex talking about the Baptist pastor who had never heard that anybody said that the body of Christ didn't begin in Acts 2. What was going on in Acts 2, according to Acts 2 and 3, according to Peter, filled with the Spirit of God, speaking, the Spirit gave him utterance, was that which is spoken by the mouth of all the holy prophets since the world began. Peter stands up at the day of Pentecost and he says, this is that which is spoken by the prophet Joel. I think that God the Holy Ghost knew what he was doing on the day of Pentecost. And when God the Holy Spirit, through the mouth of the Apostle Peter, speaking as the Spirit gave him utterance, said, what I'm doing is fulfilling Joel chapter 2, verse 28. I think that's what he was doing. Because that's what God said. Now, if your church comes along, your teacher comes along, your theology comes along, says something different, well, then you and the Holy Spirit argue it out. But Peter's pretty clear. What's going on in his ministry is that which Christ taught him to do and that which is spoken by the mouth of all the holy prophets since the world began. Later on, the Lord Jesus Christ from heaven saves Saul of Tarsus, makes him Paul the apostles, and commits to him the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began, but now is made manifest. I've said it so many times, I'm embarrassed to say it again. A six-year-old kid that flunked kindergarten can see the difference in that. Guys with more degrees than they got temperature can't get it. And the reason they can't is because they got fever. Religious fever. Religious fervor. And it blinds their mind. Yeah. Paul said when he got saved, he said, I was profiting in the Jews' religion above many mine equal. And I count all the... You know, that guy lost a fortune when he got saved. He had it made in the shade. And he counted all but loss. A lot of folks don't want to do that. The difference between what's going on in prophecy and what's going on in Pentecost with Peter, Jesus Christ administered the circumcision. But the fall, through the fall of Israel, salvation is going to the Gentiles. When it did, verse 15, nevertheless, brethren, I have written unto you the more boldly unto you, in some sort putting you in mind because of the grace that was given to me of God, that I should be the minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles. Verse 8, Christ is the minister of the circumcision. Now Christ has a minister to the Gentiles, Paul. That's why in chapter 11 he says, I speak to you Gentiles inasmuch as I am the apostle of the Gentiles. Who made him that? Jesus Christ did. How did he do it? He arrested him on the road to Damascus and saved him. But he didn't put him in Israel's program, he put him in a new program. Verse 16, that I should be the minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles, ministering the gospel of God, and the offering up of the Gentiles, that the offering up of the Gentiles might be acceptable, being sanctified by the Holy Ghost. So the whole Godhead's involved in what Paul's doing. I have therefore, whereof I may glory through Jesus Christ in things that pertain to God. For I will not dare to speak any of those things which Christ hath not wrought by me, to make the Gentiles obedient by word and deed, through mighty signs and wonders by the power of the Spirit of God, so that from Jerusalem and round about unto Illyricum, I have fully preached the gospel of Christ. So have I strived to preach the gospel, not where Christ was named, lest I should build upon another man's foundation, not going to build on Peter's foundation, but as it is written, to whom he was not spoken of, they shall see. And they that have not heard shall understand. For which cause, now watch, also I have been much hindered from coming to you. I've been busy. But now watch this, having no more place in these parts, having a great desire these many years to come unto you, whensoever I take my journey into Spain, I will come to you. For I trust to see you in my journey and be brought on my way thitherward by you. The dude's planning to go to Spain. And what he's saying is, look, I've preached all over Asia Minor. We call it Turkey. I've preached all over Macedonia, Greece. There's nowhere else for me to preach here. So I'm planning a journey to Spain. And when I go, I'm going to stop in Italy and see you guys. Y'all already say, and let you help me on the way. When he said, there's no more place for me to preach in these parts, was everybody saved in Greece and Turkey? No. What's he mean? He said, they don't need me. There's people there doing the work. The work's being done. Their church is there accomplishing the work, and you don't need me anymore to pioneer the work. I'm going to go where there aren't anybody. I'm going to go out to the regions beyond. He does the same thing at Thessalonica. Look at 1 Thessalonians. I read that and I think, wow. 1 Thessalonians chapter number 1, verse 6. I'll start in verse 5. I'm sorry. For our gospel came not unto you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Ghost and with much assurance. As you know what manner of men we were among you for your sakes, and you became followers of us and of the Lord, having received of the word in much affliction, with joy of the Holy Ghost, so that ye were examples to all that believe in Macedonia and Achaia. Now we're not in Turkey, we're over in Greece. For from you sounded out the word of the Lord, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place your faith to God were to spread abroad, so that we need not speak anything. And he says, so we need not speak anything. He's not talking about, everybody knows you so well, I don't need to tell them about you. He said, you guys have put the gospel out so effectively in that whole region that I don't need to go preach. You're doing it. You're getting the job done. I don't need to come. I can go somewhere else. What he did is he turned and trusted the ministry to them, and they were doing the job so effectively, that region didn't need him. I say, whoa. How'd he do that? Look at Acts 13. Acts 14. Here's the model that Paul followed. And again, a local church is a group of believers who meet together in one geographic location. They're led by doctrinally and personally sound elders, assisted by deacons, and they're meeting for the purpose of doing the work of the ministry. This is the work of the ministry. And it results in individuals growing to maturity and the group growing to maturity and becoming an attractive witness for Christ in a community that forms the basis of taking the gospel to lost people in that community and in that culture and that whole region. This is what Paul did all along. In Acts 13 and 14, it's his first apostolic journey. Paul did not go on missionary journeys. That's what missionaries tell you. Missionaries are not a Bible phenomenon. They are a corporate religious phenomenon. Okay? When you see mission societies and missionaries, that kind of stuff, they're almost always organized according to corporate structure and religion, not the Bible. Paul took apostolic journeys. He was an apostle. There's not a verse in the Bible that says Paul was an evangelist. There's not a verse in the Bible that says Paul was a pastor. There's not a verse in the Bible that says Paul was a missionary. There are numerous verses that says he was an apostle. So when he took a journey, it was an apostolic journey. Okay? Missionaries are not apostles. Okay? They're just preachers. I'm not putting down missionaries. I'm for missionaries. I'm for getting the gospel out. But I'm not for the denominational structure in it. They're not doing anything where they are that you and I aren't to be doing here. And if we're to be doing it here and they're doing it there, it's all the same. Acts 14, verse 21. Well, if you start in verse 19. I love this. This is a passage I think is just so exciting. Paul's been preaching, Acts 13, Acts 14. He's had these things happen with him. Verse 19, and there came thither certain Jews from Antioch and Iconium, who persuaded the people, and having stoned Paul, drew him out of the city, supposing that he'd been dead. Dr. Henry Gruber used to say the only followers Paul had in the book of Acts were his enemies. They followed him from place to place to place. And they come in here and they persuade these folks to stone him. They drag him out of the city. If they presumed him to be dead, that's what they wanted. I bet he was dead. You say, he was. Howbeit, as the disciples stood around about him, he rose up and came into the city. Now, I don't know if you get pelted with rocks at the place people think you're dead, you don't just jump right up and walk into town and then take a journey the next day. I tell you, this is the time 14 years ago, 2 Corinthians chapter 12, where he says, I knew a man, whether in the body or out of the body, I cannot tell. Paul didn't know if he's dead or not. So I can't tell you he was for sure because Paul didn't know. But he said, "He was, I don't know if he's in the body or out of the body. I cannot tell, but he's caught up to the third heaven. And he saw some things up in the third heaven. He says, it's not lawful for me to speak. Then he comes. Then God raises him up. And the next day, he what did he do? He rose up and did what? Went back into the city. And the next day he departed. You read Paul's ministry up to this point. Every time a city rejected him, you know what he did? He left. This time he goes back into it. From here on out, Paul acts like a suicidal maniac. He risks his life. He does things that you'd think anybody cautious wouldn't do. He never had a fear of death. You know, if you've been to the third heaven and you've seen what's there and it was so wonderful that you couldn't tell people about it, you couldn't express it in words, it's unspeakable, would you be afraid of dying and going back? He the rest of his life, he's living like a suicidal maniac, running right into the teeth of the lion. So what's he do? Verse 21. Now watch. When he had preached the gospel to that city and had taught many, He returned again to Lystra and Iconium and Antioch, confirming the souls of the disciples and exhorting them to continue in the faith, that we must through much tribulation enter into the kingdom of God. Notice what he does. First thing he does, God would have all men to be saved. He preached the gospel in that city. Evangelism was the first thing Paul did when he went into town. He didn't take the temperature of the he went in and preached the gospel. Notice he preached the gospel to that city. He didn't go to the boonies and preach to cows. Years ago, when I first started preaching, I was in Alabama. My wife and I lived 17 miles outside of the nearest town. And I used to go around in the walk around in the woods there, and just have a little time to myself and pray and preach. I preached a lot of trees, a lot of squirrels, a lot of cows, because that's what's in the woods. But then I would go to town and preach on the street because that's where the people are. Paul focused on where the people were because that's who needed to get saved. His evangelism focused on population centers, major population centers. So the work of the ministry in putting local churches, where should you put local churches? Where the people are, because that's where the problems are. And where the problems are, people are going to come up with solutions to the problems. And if the truth isn't there, they're going to come up with solutions to the problems without the truth, with a lie program. That's what you see in politics. That's what you see in the world today. So he goes into the population center and he goes and preaches the gospel to the strategic population centers of a region. You'll see him do this over and over in the book of Acts. Then he taught many. And he returned again to do what? Confirm the souls. Now he's going to go into the edification process. He's going to instruct new believers. He's going to edify them. 1 Timothy. What does he tell Timothy? The first thing to do, don't change the doctrine, don't pay attention to fables, don't pay attention to endless genealogies, but give yourself rather to godly edifying. Edify the saints in the truth of God's word. He calls them, grow up in grace. Colossians chapter 1, verse number 9. If you wanted a passage to make a life verse for your family, Colossians chapter 1, verse 9. For this cause also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to desire that you might be filled with the knowledge of His will and all wisdom and spiritual understanding. Know what God's will is. So you've got some knowledge and understanding of it so you know how to apply it in your life. Why? That you may walk worthy of the Lord and all pleasing, being fruitful unto every good work, increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might. He wants you to be fruitful. He wants you to be growing. He wants you to be strong. He wants you to be thankful. And all that comes by the edification process of knowing, being filled with the knowledge of His will and all spirit. So he goes through that edification process, grows them up. Then verse 23, and by the way, verse 22, that they must through much tribulation. Listen. You're going to need to be strong in the Lord and in understanding what He's doing so you can get through life. I know people say, come get saved and everything will be wonderful. You know better than that. You want life to be wonderful, happy, your life's been miserable. Come get saved. Listen, when I got saved, my life was happy. I wasn't miserable. I had a happy life. I got saved, and it wasn't three weeks, I was in trouble for having gotten saved. The preacher was mad at me, the youth director was mad at me, my mom and dad were mad at me for different reasons. My mom and dad were mad at me because the preacher was mad at me. He was mad at me because he didn't understand what had happened to me. I got saved. He said, no, you've always been saved. You won the Teenager of the Year Award last year for your age group. I said, no, I got saved right on that organ bench the other night. And, I mean, had a fit. There are going to be problems. You need to understand that. Grace tells you that. You be strengthened, you be strong, grow, understand these things. And when they had ordained, verse 20, ordained elders in every church. You know what he's doing? Now he's gathering those saints together who've been edified, and he gathers them together and he establishes a local church. And if you want to see how a local church needs to be established, go to the book of Titus, where he tells Titus, I left you in Crete to set things in order that are wanting. And then he talks to him about how to do it. First thing is to ordain the elders, the leaders, get some men that are strong in doctrine and character, living the doctrine, and put them in leadership of the assembly, to oversee the assembly, have the qualified leaders, have the sound living. Titus chapter 2 is all about sound doctrine, living in people, the discipline necessary. That's the group. That's, you got the fellowship organized, working together. And then what does he do? They commended them to the Lord, on whom they believe. When he says, that's not, Lord bless you and keep you, brethren. That's religious hokum. Nobody ever got a blessing by somebody doing that. You know, that's all you nuts get off the grass. That's all that is. When he says he commended them to the Lord, what did he commend them to? He commended them to the evangelism, the edification, and the establishment of that assembly. He commended them to the work of the ministry that they had just performed. And he entrusts them with that responsibility of getting that message out. And you know what he did? He used that group as a base then to go to the next place. That's why he told them in Romans 15, I'm going to visit you in Rome so that you then can help me on my way. You're a base to help me go on. That's why in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, he talks about people giving him money, offerings, to carry on the work of the ministry. And he said, my rule is that I reach as far as the supply provides, to the regions beyond. So what he does is he uses that local assembly as a base then to reach beyond with the gospel. So when you go through Paul's epistles, you see what the labor of the work of the ministry is all about. So when you think about Labor Day, and I think about Labor Day in the church, and what we're doing as an assembly and working in the church, the labor that we're involved in what Paul's doing. And his Labor Day message, the model, is you start with evangelism. You take people that get saved and then you edify them and help them grow so they can become sound in their life and their doctrine. Then you organize them into a work of the ministry, a group of people working to do the work of the ministry, which is to see people get saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. And then as they do that, that becomes a basis to reach out in the next group. And that cycle, what a local church needs to be about is carrying on that cycle, that life cycle, all the time being one of those steps, function along. And you as a member of the local assembly need to know where you are in that cycle. Don't get stuck in one point. Don't get stuck in I'll just come and sit and learn and sit and learn and sit and learn. Sit and learn so that you can then have ministry entrusted to you. Some of you guys could develop ministries. Some of you have developed ministries that will reach places, Pastor Curtis and I would never even think about it. That's how the work gets done. The local church is a place where the word is sounded out, where it's proclaimed. It's a place where the saints are edified and established in the faith. You know, I think about what Paul said about Thessalonians. If Paul came back today and visited Chicago, I've prayed for 40 years that if Paul came back, he'd say, I don't need to preach in Chicago because the work's getting done. Probably wouldn't say that, but I wish he would. I wish it would be that we were doing the work so effectively that he wouldn't think he's needed, because what he would do would be what we would do, and what we would do is what he would have done. You follow that? That's the goal. the local church is a place where the truth is defended and protected. It's our function to defend the truth, not just proclaim it, but to protect it. It's a place where the saints are cared for. Fellowship. You incorporate God's people into a community, into a group. That's what membership is about, where you identify together and where you're cared for. And that's the local church is the only place that can really happen adequately. The way a lot of folks are lost to the truth is that no one is there when the trouble when that person gets in trouble. No one is there to build them up and to help them bear through the trying times of life, to be the comfort and the edification. A local church is a place where you can be comforted with the comfort wherewith you can comfort others with the comfort wherewith you're comforted of God. You have friends. It's a place where you train leaders to do the work of the ministry. It's a place where Christ is preeminent. He's the issue. When you have something with someone else, you're not the issue, they're not the issue, he is. It's a place where the joy of serving the Lord is a reality. In my life, a verse of Scripture that completely changed my whole ministry, I've told you this many times, it's the last verse in 2 Corinthians chapter 1. Paul says, not for that we have dominion over your faith. Do you know how discouraging it would be if I thought I had to have responsibility for what you do? Dominion over you, tell you. I have hard enough telling myself what to do. I mean, my wife can't even tell me what to do most of the time. Now, she tries, and she's smarter about it than I am. But I wouldn't have any way to, not that I'm going to have dominion over your faith. I wouldn't want that job. But we're helpers together of your, listen, joy. My job is to help you rejoice in the Lord and the riches of his grace to you in Christ. For by faith you stand. You stand in your life by your faith resting in who God has made you in his Son. And the joy of that, the thrill of that, the truth of that, is what our assembly is about. That's the attitude that we carry on the work of the ministry with. And that joy of the Lord, that joy that's ours in the Lord, that's what makes the labor not in vain. It's not us, it's him. It's not a religious bondage that we're a part of. It's life in Christ Jesus. And you know, when you can do that, you have that in your home, you have that in your life, you'll be like a shining light on a dark street in your neighborhood, because nobody else in town is going to know how to do it. Even the religious people are just striving in ways that don't work. That's what a local church is about. So on Labor Day, what's a local church to labor in? Okay? Praise the Lord. Father, we thank you this morning for your love and your grace. The privilege to be laborers together with you to honor our Savior, whose name we pray. Amen. We're going to stand and